first driving video. It's not going to be crazy or anything. There's a lot of traffic around here. You can see how quiet this, you roll up the windows, how quiet this car can be. It just kind of purrs. It can get loud when you really step into it and get the revs up, but it's just kind of idling at 1500, cruising about 45 miles an hour. Let me step into it maybe halfway. I love that sound. For the first few weeks, it was a battle to not stare at the miles per gallon gauge on this thing. Kind of depressing. It was averaging about 14. Keep in mind, I do mostly city. My highway is real short for commute, so this is all mostly city. And I kind of mellowed out a little bit, and it's coming up to like 14.7, 14.8 average. So I finally just got rid of that screen. You can't really worry about that forever. So I always have the oil temp is on my MFD in the front of the steering wheel now. You probably can't see it from there. So I like watching the oil temp rise up to operating temperature each time I drive it. The max is about 230 Fahrenheit. Probably right now it's 210. I'm going real mellow. I seen it at like 238, 239 when I was driving hard. And the coolant almost never gets above 200, so the oil does run hotter. This kind of is different than my GTI results for oil temp, which of course was a fake calculated temp, and now I realize it was completely wrong anyway. Start here. It kills me making these videos because I waste so much gas. I'm usually just putting around, just cruising. It's sort of like, feels like a Cadillac to me. And I just baby the gas pedal. But I could probably watch my average miles per gallon drop a tenth every time I floor it. It's crazy. It's good from a stop, but it's amazing from a 70 mile per hour punch. That's when it really trips me out. It's fast enough from a stop. I haven't done any 0 to 60s yet to see if that 4.5 is true or attainable on this particular car. But the freeway 70, drop it down two and put it to the floor, is really what trips me out, how hard it pulls at that point. At that particular range, I think it pulls harder than my GTI did from 70 and up. But around town, it might be kind of close. The GTI would kind of catch up as it spooled. But this one just kind of has power all the time. The Brembos are as good as I remember them. It was my favorite part of my yellow Superbee, and they're just as good now. It also helps that probably the worst feature on the GTI is the brakes. And that makes the Superbee one seem even better. but it's just so little pressure, so much stopping force. You hear that little squeak? These squeak a little bit. I think it's kind of the opposite. These squeak before they're hot, but it's a very light squeak. All my other squeaks on other cars is loud, ear-piercing, and embarrassing, but this one is like so mild. It's kind of hard to hear. You got to really listen. My son is in the car now, so that's enough of that. I just want to show you the paddle shifters one last thing. Starting in first with the shifter. Isn't as slow and sluggish as I've always kind of made it out to be, nor in truth. It's a Mercedes-Benz source tranny from what I've been reading about. There's nothing wrong with it. And the more I drive it, the more I agree with a lot of people that five speeds is perfect for this V8. I'm not sure if this is a big block or not. I don't know too much about the Dodge engines, really. I haven't had time to research them. But five speeds, I mean, with this kind of power is just right. I'm in third manual, drove it in second. Instant, I mean, quick, you know, quick enough. Second up to third. Third just kind of bounces and kind of hits. It can be a lot more violent hit when you're under deep throttle. Third, second, first, instant.